Link TV, connecting you to the world. Link TV is viewer supported. Watch more at linktv.org.
Link TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Thousands take to the streets of Syria chanting, "God is with us." Yemeni opposition questions President Saleh's constitutional legitimacy. And Israel restricts access to Al-Aqsa Mosque on the first Friday of Ramadan. Mosaic, world news from the Middle East, begins now.
The Syrian opposition chose "God is with us" as the slogan of its mobilization on the first Friday of the holy month of Ramadan. As for al-Assad's regime, it is still holding on to its security slogan, rendering the shelling of tanks and gunfire the only dialogue and the only possible reforms.
The Friday of "God is with us" is the slogan chosen by the Syrian opposition to revive its mobilization on the first Friday of the holy month of Ramadan. So after Friday prayers, Syrians marched against the regime across Syrian towns and villages, specifically in Deir ez-Zor, Al-Kamishli, Amuda, Latakia, Aleppo, Hama, Rif Dimashq, Daraa, and Homs, and most notably in Al-Khalidiyya, Rastan, Baba Amer, and Deir Balba. Protesters chanted for freedom, the downfall of President Bashar al-Assad. They also chanted in solidarity with besieged cities and towns. The opposition posted this video on their websites, showing a massive demonstration in the Al-Maidan neighborhood in the center of Damascus. And this is another video showing a demonstration in Al-Qadam neighborhood in Damascus, during which protesters chanted for the victory of besieged cities. Faced with the demonstrators' perseverance, Syrian security forces and the Shabiha surrounded a number of mosques and prevented prayers as usual. Then they resorted to using live bullets in a number of areas, which led to the death and injury of dozens, specifically in Arbayin and Damascus's countryside. In Hama, snipers were deployed on rooftops and convoys of armored vehicles and tanks were spread on the streets as over 1,500 families fled the city. Meanwhile, Syrian state TV broadcast a report from Hama indicating that army units are working on re-establishing security and stability in the city by opening roads and removing roadblocks put in place by what the channel called armed terrorist groups.
However, images of buildings and mosques in Hama tell the channel's inciting chaos and their supporters, die of frustration, die of anger.
However, those who worked on this report ignored the scale of destruction it portrays, clearly indicating the scale of destruction in Hama, the result of indiscriminately using machine guns and heavy weaponry. In Homs, activists and eyewitnesses reported that a large number of security forces and armed regime loyalists surrounded the city's Baba Amer neighborhood. They added that these forces stormed the neighborhood amid heavy gunfire and shelling.
And despite all these measures, some streets in Homs were filled with demonstrators.
In Yemen, the youth of the revolution have gathered in more than 17 provinces on a Friday dubbed a peaceful revolution until victory, demanding the ouster of those being referred to as the remnants of the regime. On the other side, supporters of President Ali Abdullah Saleh gathered at Sab'een Square in a protest rally entitled Friday of Compassion, renewing their allegiance to what they referred to as constitutional legitimacy. At the political level, legal debate is taking place in Yemen about the legitimacy of President Saleh in light of his 60-day absence from the country and his failure to perform his duties as claimed by his opponents.
سلمية حتى النصر. جمعة جديدة لثوار اليمن لترسيخ سلمية نضالهم والأمل بقرب الحسم.
Peaceful until victory. It's a new Friday marked by the revolutionaries of Yemen. The protesters stress the peaceful nature of their struggle amid a renewed hope of soon toppling the regime. The youths of the revolution, following 25 Fridays, have vowed to remain steadfast across 17 protest squares in the face of what they refer to as the remnants of the regime. They chanted slogans against what they described as a collective starvation policy and an interruption of basic services in an attempt by the regime to sway them from achieving the goals of their revolution. As Saleh's absence enters its 60th day, his supporters gathered at Sabine Square under the slogan, Friday of Compassion.
وكعادتهم جدد مؤيد النظام تمسكهم بما يطلقون عليها الشرعية الدستورية ورفضهم لكل
As usual, the regime supporters renewed their allegiance to what they referred to as constitutional legitimacy. They also rejected what they described as attempts of defectors in reference to the revolution's youths who are demanding the ouster of the regime and the trial of its pillars. Two Friday rallies are being held simultaneously amid a heated political debate about the legitimacy of President Saleh, who has been absent from the country for 60 days.
رئاسة في يونيو حزيران الماضي. الفريق المؤيد لانتهاء شرعية صالح
Saleh is being treated in Riyadh for serious injuries he sustained in an attack on the presidential palace last June. The team in favor of stripping Saleh's presidency has cited legal provisions mandating the president transfer power to his deputy or to parliament if his position remains unfilled for 2 months or if he is found permanently incompetent to perform his duties. The team also stressed that the vice president Abdul Rabu Mansour Hadi must call for presidential elections after running the country's affairs during the transitional period as mandated by the Constitution.
متشبثا بشرعية صالح إلى حين انتخاب رئيس جديد للبلاد. يتعلل هذا الفريق بأن صالح
However, the ruling Congress party has totally opposed the argument, saying that Saleh is still legitimate until a new president is elected for the country. The opposing team argues that Saleh was not permanently injured, claiming that he is still performing his duties from abroad, citing his recent meeting with the U.S. representative. They argue that he is on a medical leave of absence due to burns. This legal debate comes amid military escalation across various fronts in Arhab, Taiz, and Abiyan, with speculation of the resumption of fighting in the Hasaba front in the Yemeni capital, which is home to Sadiq al-Akhmar, the sheikh of the Hashid tribe. Incoming reports have confirmed that forces loyal to President Saleh were deployed in neighborhoods adjacent to Hasaba. Meanwhile, armed supporters of al-Akhmar are reportedly digging trenches in anticipation of possible confrontations. The sheikh of Hashid vowed that Saleh will not rule Yemen as long as he's alive.
نفت حكومة العقيد ليبي معمر القذافي الأنباء التي ترددت عن مقتل خميس
Libyan Colonel Muammar al-Gaddafi's government denied the circulating reports about the killing of Khamis, his youngest son, and a prominent military commander. The Libyan authorities said these reports are groundless. Earlier today, NATO warplanes bombed targets in a southern suburb of the capital Tripoli. Meanwhile, the Libyan authorities announced that their forces took control of the town of Zlitan, east of the capital. In the outskirts of Misrata, dozens of Gaddafi soldiers' bodies were found. Their bodies were tossed onto the shore by waves after their failed attempt to reach the city by sea.
محاولة إنزال بحري فاشلة قبالة المدينة.
هنا مدينة زلاتان.
This is the city of Zlitan, a city still under the control of Colonel Muammar al-Qaddafi's supporters. It is still a target for NATO warplanes. In this house, a mother and her two children were killed after a rocket hit their home. NATO did not deny launching an airstrike in the area, but affirmed that the killing of civilians calls for an investigation. In Misrata, east of Zlitan, a funeral is being held for the people killed by rockets launched by Gaddafi's soldiers.
لا تزال المعارك على أشدها بين المناوئين والمؤيدين للقذافي.
Battles in Misrata are still ferocious between opponents and supporters of Gaddafi. It took the opposition forces months to reach Zlitan, and it would not have been achieved without NATO protecting the revolutionaries by air. The armed opposition fighters are not only launching attacks on land, but have also begun attacks at sea. They seized an oil tanker heading from Malta to regions under the control of Gaddafi supporters and rerouted it to Benghazi.
وبالتوازي مع الأعمال العسكرية تسير العملية السياسية.
Parallel to the military operations, the political process is ongoing as well. The Transitional Council insists that Gaddafi and his children not only relinquish power, but leave the country completely.
الدولية مع ازدياد عدد المعترفين به ممثلا شرعيا وحيدا للشعب.
The council began expanding its activities internationally as more countries recognize it as the only legitimate representative for the Libyan people. As for the regime, it sent its envoy to Latin America to explain the truth of what is happening in Libya and its leaders' readiness to conduct elections under the conditions that NATO stops its military operations.
أو أدنى من التحقق للقضاء على المعارضين الليبراليين. تصريحات تسابق الإسلام.
Meanwhile, Saif al-Islam al-Qaddafi says an alliance with the Islamists is around the corner in order to eliminate the liberal opposition.
تفاوض مع الإسلاميين بصفته الشخصية.
Al-Qaeda issued a statement.
تظاهر عشرات الأشخاص أمام مسجد عمر مكرم المطل على ميدان التحرير بعد أداء صلاة الغائب.
Dozens of people protested in front of Omar Makram Mosque, overlooking Tahrir Square, after performing prayers for activist Mohammed Mohsen, who died after being wounded in the Abbasiyah incidents about 2 weeks ago. The protesters chanted slogans against the military council, while some activists condemned the security measures taken by the army around the area. It is worth mentioning that more than 100 people were injured in the clashes that occurred during the march organized by Tahrir Square protesters towards the Defense Ministry headquarters 2 weeks ago.
The Israeli occupation imposed heightened security measures at the main entrances of occupied Jerusalem on the first Friday of the holy month of Ramadan. The occupation barred anyone under the age of 40 from entering the city to perform Friday prayers in the noble Al-Aqsa Mosque.
During the first hours of dawn, Palestinians came from across the West Bank cities and villages to the main entrances of Jerusalem to perform prayers on the first Friday of the holy month. In the hot sun, they waited for the Israeli jailers to allow them to enter the city. However, only a small number of elderly people were allowed in, and the majority performed prayers at the occupation's checkpoints that separate them from the blessed Al-Aqsa Mosque.
We've been here since 6 a.m., and now it's 8:30, and we're still standing. We're exhausted. I'm sick and feel terrible. I can't believe it.
Once we leave this area, it's possible to enter from here, but they make us return to the first or second or third checkpoint. This is happening to a lot of people here.
I tried to go in, but they made me return. The first time they said I wasn't the legal age. They made me go back a second and third time. They allowed me to go in on the fourth try. I crossed the first and second checkpoints, but they made me go back at the third checkpoint.
The scene is not very different in the sacred city. Dozens of checkpoints were set up at the main entrances of the old town's gates that lead to the blessed Al-Aqsa Mosque. And amid inspections and occupation measures, the city seems to be occupied once again.
The enemy shut down everything. It is waging a war against us on all fronts. It is using all means to fight against us, all means. But believe me, our faith in the Almighty God is the only thing that keeps us strong. May God's will be to keep our faith strong and make us love each other.
Old men and women are all standing. They're not allowed to enter in cars or buses. The situation can only be solved by God.
It is worth mentioning that the occupation's authorities are heavily reinforcing their presence during the holy month. The occupation transformed the city of Jerusalem into a military zone on this day. But despite these occupation's measures, tens of thousands of Palestinians entered the city and performed their prayers at Al-Aqsa, also known as the first Muslim Qibla and the third noble sanctuary. Hader Shaheen, Al-Alam, occupied Jerusalem.
At least 14 people have died of hunger in Kenya's northeastern Turkana region. They're the first hunger-related deaths reported in Kenya during the current regional drought. The victims are from three remote villages in the drought-hit areas that the government failed to get supplies to. The United Nations says starvation threatens more than 4 million Kenyans in the region. According to the world body, the drought has been caused by a lack of rainfall over successive years. The other countries affected are Somalia, Ethiopia, and Djibouti. About 1,300 Somalis, mostly women and children, are crossing into Kenya each day in search of food.
The plight of a decades-long civil war in Somalia has been exacerbated by a catastrophic famine and drought, the worst in 60 years. Here in Somalia, it's a matter of life and death to get your hand on food, any food. The UN has estimated more than 3 million people in Somalia need immediate, life-saving humanitarian assistance. The famine is said to have killed more than 29,000 children under the age of 5 in the country's south over the past 90 days. The Food and Agriculture Organization, the United Nations food arm, has warned the famine is likely to spread across all regions of Somalia's south in the next 4 to 6 weeks. With 640,000 children acutely malnourished, a slow death is spreading its shadow in the East African country. The international community is under fire for what many call an inadequate response to the disaster. The United Nations has called for some $2 billion to provide emergency assistance for famine relief in the Horn of Africa. But up until now, only half of that amount has been committed. The World Food Program has called for an extra $360 million in urgent funds, a little more than the amount that the U.S. is spending on its unpopular wars in Iraq and Afghanistan every single day. Ironically enough, while tens of thousands of people have already starved to death and many more are in desperate need of food in the Horn of Africa, many are dying from obesity in rich countries such as the United States.
Well, let's move on with the news now. Reports say at least 3 Palestinians have been injured in fresh Israeli attacks on the Gaza Strip. Let's get more now from our correspondent, Ashraf Shannon, who's joining us live from Gaza. Ashraf, over to you.
Yes, Homa, today Israeli Air Force fired at least 5 rockets into the Gaza Strip. One of the rockets that hit northern Gaza injured 3 people, including 2 in serious condition and 1 child. The 2 young men who were seriously injured lost both lower limbs. Yesterday also, Israeli Air Force fired at least 6 rockets in the Gaza Strip. So since yesterday, we have 11 airstrikes on Gaza. This comes amid renewed Israeli threats against the Gaza Strip, especially by the Israeli Army Chief of Staff, who also deployed that system that's called the Iron Dome around the Gaza Strip. Israel accuses Gazan fighters of firing homemade rockets into its territory.
Israeli Air Force jets struck several targets in the Gaza Strip early this morning in response to the increased Palestinian firing of rockets into Israel in recent days. The IDF spokesperson confirmed that the IAF hit 4 tunnels used for terror activity, as well as a Hamas training camp in central Gaza. Significant damage was caused to several buildings in the Khan Yunis refugee camp, but no injuries were reported. The IDF spokesperson added that Israel holds Hamas responsible for maintaining calm inside the Strip. Last night, Palestinians fired 1 Grad rocket into the southern Lachish region, landing in an open area between Sderot and Kiryat Gat. 1 woman suffered anxiety from the strike, although no other injuries or damage were reported in that attack. In another move aimed at countering the increasing rocket fire from Gaza, Defense Minister Ehud Barak today decided to redeploy a battery of the Iron Dome anti-missile defense system outside the southern city of Ashkelon. The move follows repeated demands from leaders of the local authorities and communities in the region, headed by Ashkelon Mayor Benny Vaknin. Since the start of July, some 30 rockets have been fired into the area. Now to the ongoing wave of social protests sweeping the nation, and organizers of the so-called Tent City demonstrations are preparing for what they're calling the mother of all protests, slated to be held in Tel Aviv tomorrow night. Demonstrators plan to march from the Rothschild Boulevard tent encampment to the city's Kaplan Street, where a mass rally will be held with over 200,000 other people expected to simultaneously gather for separate demonstrations nationwide. Last night, the Histadrut Labor Federation officially joined the protests against housing costs, and an estimated 10,000 workers from both the public and private sectors attended a rally outside the organization's Tel Aviv headquarters. Histadrut Chairman Ofer Einy addressed the crowd, telling organizers of the Tent City campaign that his federation will follow their lead in order to bring about true social change here in Israel. Einy also slammed the government for its policies and urged Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to listen to the people. Also addressing the ongoing social unrest, opposition chairwoman Tzipi Livni has once again lashed out at Prime Minister Netanyahu. Speaking at a gathering of the Kadima Party in Petah Tikva, Livni called Netanyahu's economic policies extremist and claimed that similar strategies have failed when attempted in other countries. The Kadima chairwoman accused the prime minister of only caring about bringing about an end of the protests rather than actually correcting the situation. Livni's party rival, MK Shaul Mofaz, also issued a fierce attack against the prime minister, saying that this guy was born with a silver spoon in his mouth and has no idea what it's like to pay a mortgage like regular Israelis do. Mofaz went on to say that in the past 2 years, Netanyahu trampled the middle class, harmed the young people who are Israel's future, and has taken away their hopes, before Mofaz called for Netanyahu's downfall in a democratic fashion. A spokesman for the prime minister's Likud party shot back that it was a Kadima-led government that stopped building apartments in the center of the country, also stopped paving roads to outlying areas, and failed to invest in higher education, before she accused Kadima of now acting out of panic due to its own poor standing in the public opinion polls.
Kurdish activists and intellectuals announced the formation of a civil organization to support the establishment of an independent state of Kurdistan. They confirmed that conditions are ripe for establishing a state in light of the changes in the Arab world. They say that Kurdistan is economically ready because of its resources. Meanwhile, some believe the announcement may collide with regional positions that clearly reject the plan.
لا يعتبر سعي الكرد نحو قيام دولة كردية مستقلة وليد التطورات السياسية.
The Kurds' quest to establish an independent Kurdish state is not the consequence of the current political developments in Iraq, nor is it the result of discrimination as claimed by some Iraqi provinces over the past few months. That claim was used as a threat to secede as an independent region if the central government did not rush the review of the region's share of funds and jurisdiction. The Kurds' request for an independent state is a renewed old issue that can be traced back to the hardship they faced after the division of the region. In 1916, the Kurds were spread across Iraq, Syria, Turkey, and Iran in accordance with the Sykes-Picot Agreement, which divided the regions in West Asia that were under the French-British mandate. The Kurdish activist New Movement to establish their proposed state may have been encouraged by the developments and changes the Arab region is witnessing. The independence of South Sudan in July has set an example for being a state that seceded from Sudan after holding a referendum on January 9th and receiving UN recognition. There is no doubt that the independence of South Sudan was an important incentive for the leaders of Kurdish parties to reintroduce the proposal for an independent Kurdish state by holding conferences and seminars. Most recently, Kurdish intellectuals and activists, including the editor-in-chief of a newspaper that represents Kurdistan Region President Masoud al-Barzani, announced at a press conference the formation of an organization to support the establishment of an independent Kurdish state.
والذي وصفه الرئيس جلال طلباني أحد زعماء الكرد البارزين في لقاء صحفي قبل سنوات بمجرد حلم.
In an interview several years ago, prominent Kurdish leader and Iraqi president Jalal Talabani described such a move as merely a dream. The political struggle that Iraq is currently witnessing and their quest to establish autonomous regions in most provinces have facilitated the Kurdish party's mobilization and set the groundwork for calling for the region's independence, especially since the Iraqi street and politicians seem frustrated with the Kurds' many demands and their ways of dealing with citizens, which have made the region's border seem as though it is the border of a neighboring state. The Arab-Iraqi street that opposed any separation proposal submitted by the Kurds is now preoccupied with its security and economic issues and is indifferent about the Kurds' demands. This was clear due to the fact that there was no strong opposition, as there has been in the past. Some observers believe the Iraqi street seems ready, more than ever, to agree to the Kurds' right to self-determination, since their presence is seen as a political, economic, and security burden. And despite all the domestic circumstances that seem well suited for the Kurds to announce their state, they will undoubtedly face regional positions that clearly reject the establishment of the state. Among those who oppose the proposal are Iran and Turkey, where nearly 22 million Kurds live. The two states have repeatedly warned that they will not allow the secession of Kurdistan. On the basis of Tehran and Ankara's former positions on the hypothetical Kurdish state, not only will it be economically besieged, but also subject to military attacks since it lacks a seaport. This theory may be the main reason that is preventing Kurdish leaders to take action at the United Nations and demand their right to self-determination. They are aware that any Turkish interference to prevent their request will not be opposed by the U.S. and its allies, who consider Ankara to be the model for democracy and moderate Islam in the Middle East. In addition, any Iranian interference to abort the Kurdish attempt at statehood will not be opposed. This was made clear by the ongoing Iranian military operations in the Kurdistan region.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible by grants from the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Firedoll Foundation, and by support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online. Stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows and more at linktv.org/mosaic. This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.